26 years ago, my boss carried in a blue and white PowerMac along with a boxed copy of MacOS 10 server. This was Apple's Rhapsody era, the missing link between NeXTSTEP and modern OS 10. But wait, aren't we missing a zip drive here? And why does the CD-ROM keep spitting its tray? Plus, how to make the G3 multi-boot between Rhapsody, macOS 8 and OS 10 anyway? What could possibly go wrong? Under the dust, there's history waiting to boot. I'm the Vintage Collector and these are my stories. So, when I got the chance to acquire this blue and white PowerMac G3 some 2 years ago, I took it along. Still, the machine sat around for quite some time. At first, I didn't have the matching Apple display. I would have loved to get the CRT, but eventually I came by a 15-inch blue and white LCD studio display, although without the power supply. So I was scouting then for that one too. And I was furtherly looking into getting a matching SIP100 drive. Like the iconic iMac G3, which came in 1998 and did away with legacy components, the blue and white PowerMac G3 dropped SCSI support in favor of FireWire, removed the floppy drive and kept only one single ADB port. The SIP100 wasn't standard though, but offered only as an option for selected Apple machines. Still, I was curious to see that one interacting in combination with OS X server and the Blue Box compatibility environment. Before we go any further, a quick thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring this episode. This month they've got some neat specials. You can now order the brand new purple solder mask at no extra cost, making your board stand out right from the start. And in 3D printing, TPU material is heavily discounted, up to 80% off if your part weighs over 64 grams. On top of that, PCBWay is running their 8th project design contest, a great chance to share your ideas with the maker community and win attractive prizes. Links are down below, and now back to the PowerMac G3. The zip drive mounts to a spare 3.5-inch bay just beneath the CD-ROM drive and like the former connects to the IDE bus. As mentioned before, the PowerMac G3 dropped SCSI support and came with all IDE drives instead. That being said, the early mainboard revision had issues with the IDE controller, which made it impossible to use more than one IDE hard drive. I found this machine equipped with an AdaptX SCSI controller and a SCSI hard drive. Maybe a sign for a first-gen machine to overcome stability issues simply by using SCSI. But it turned out to be a second-generation mainboard. Hence, I could easily swap the SCSI with IDE drives, but I decided to leave it as is. What I totally couldn't leave alone though was those missing slot brackets. Seriously, no. The blue and white G3 was short-lived, produced only from January through August 1999 before being replaced by the more serious-looking PowerMac G4, even though the latter was still built around the same base design of the chassis. This system supported up to 1 GB of RAM, while this particular machine has 256 MB installed. It also shipped with an ATI Rage 128 graphics card, conveniently using a standard VGA connector. I first tried running it through a modern VGA capture device, but the video kept freezing, so for this episode I'll fall back to direct camera recording. Internally, Apple called this model Yosemite. And fun fact, that name resurfaced 15 years later, in October 2014, as OS X 10.10 Yosemite. The PowerMac G3 also adopted the translucent USB keyboard and the HockeyPock mouse from the iMac G3. And you know the game, it needs a good cleaning before I really dare touching it. So it didn't take too much to get the G3 into shape for doing my first startup test. Now, the G3 was one of the very first Macs coming with the new open firmware. Simply pressing C during startup should boot directly off the CD-ROM drive. But that didn't work. Instead, it always booted off the hard drive into the still installed copy of OS X. Furtherly, the Mac kept randomly ejecting the CD-ROM every few seconds, independent from whether a coaster was inserted or not. So I was grabbing a replacement drive and tried again. And that worked, launching directly into macOS whilst pressing C right after the boot chime.
Wait a second, you said you're going to install Rhapsody, not macOS.
True, but macOS X Server 1.0 used a version of the classic macOS as an installation environment. Strange enough, but exactly as it should be. And that leads me to a short detour and some preparational hints if you're like me, heading for a multi-boot environment. As I installed OS X Server 1.0 right away, I later found out that it grabbed the entire hard drive. Even so, I had directed it to use only parts of the hard drive for the Rhapsody partitions. I really struggled to edit the BSD disk label for unclaiming the free disk space for other operating systems. Hence I started over defining the partitions for macOS 8, macOS 9, Rhapsody and the actual OS 10 up front. This sorted the partition issues for me and my intended quad boot setup. We'll look into the multi-boot details later on. Just keep this in mind for now, as you may spot some discrepancies with the individual partitions later on, as the segments were captured at different stages throughout the process. I was then starting off installing macOS 8.6 from the second revision's recovery CD. On a side note, I totally like how the translucent design of the blue and white PowerMac is mirrored through the macOS 8.6 default wallpaper and how it also blends with those stickers found inside the machine. Turning over to macOS 10 Server 1.0, this one boots into a special macOS 9 install environment. That's a major difference from the later OS 10 10.0, which booted into a native installer.
I'm super confused. macOS 10 Server 1.0, OS 10 10.0, but then there was also OS 10 Server 10.0.
Ah yes, of course, I see that confusion. Maybe I should call it Rhapsody to better differentiate between this one and the actual OS 10, which today is, even more confusing, again known as just macOS. Rhapsody is the fifth version of Next former operating system, known as OpenStep and NeXTSTEP. It was developed shortly after the acquisition of Next by Apple in 1997. At Apple's WWDC in 1997, Steve Jobs stood on stage and laid out the plan. Rhapsody would be the bridge between Next technology and the Mac. Developers were expected to adopt a new set of APIs called the Yellow Box, derived from NeXTSTEP. Classic Mac applications, meanwhile, would run inside a compatibility layer called Blue Box. And this is exactly what you see here. The installer starts from a familiar macOS environment, but what it's really setting up is a Unix-based core inherited from NeXTSTEP. Under the hood, it's running the mock microkernel with a BSD Unix layer. The strategy was ambitious: Blue Box to run old apps, Yellow Box to build new ones. There was even talk about Redbox to run Windows apps, but that never left the planning stage. When macOS 10 Server 1.0 shipped in March 1999, it was aimed squarely at developers and IT departments, not the general Mac audience. That's why the interface still looks more like NeXTSTEP with a blend of macOS 8's Platinum UI, and why it lacks Aqua, which wouldn't appear until the public beta of OS 10 in 2000.
So basically, this was Apple's rehearsal before the big show.
One could say so. It was an intermediate step to affirm Apple's commitment to a Unix-based future, especially after previous attempts to modernize the classic macOS had collapsed. The most infamous was Copeland, a project that dragged on for years in the mid-1990s and never shipped in a usable form. As we saw in earlier episodes, Apple already had a surprising amount of Unix experience under its belt. That was AUX, Apple's own UNIX variant for 68K Macs between 1988 and 1995. Then came the Macintosh application environment, MAE, which let UNIX workstations from Sun and HP run Mac software between 1994 and 1997. And in a last-ditch attempt to keep a foot in the enterprise market, Apple even licensed IBM's AIX to power the short-lived Apple Network servers in 1996. And in parallel, Apple was also experimenting with other, sometimes contradictory, directions. One of them was a joint project with Novell and Digital Research, codenamed Star Trek, which aimed to bring the System 7 interface to Intel PCs by running it on top of DRDOS. It never went beyond the prototype, but it illustrates how uncertain Apple's strategy really was. By the mid-90s though, it was clear the classic macOS was fundamentally obsolete. It still lacked preemptive multitasking, true memory protection and process isolation. That meant a single misbehaving application could bring down the entire system, something competitors like Windows NT and Unix had already solved. So instead, Apple went shopping. Apple explored buying BE Incorporated, makers of the BOS, a system praised for its multimedia performance and clean design. But the negotiations fell apart, BE wanted around $300 million, Apple was only willing to pay $127 million. Ironically, Apple ended up spending more than $400 million to buy NeXT instead. But with NeXT, Apple didn't just get an operating system, they also got Steve Jobs back, plus an engineering team and technology stack mature enough to form the foundation of what would ultimately become macOS X. Meanwhile, the installation has finished and we're greeted with a first-time setup assistant that looks a lot like the one from macOS 8. The user interface shows some familiar touches, but also clear signs of its NeXTSTEP heritage. The best example is the file browser. The column view, introduced in NeXTSTEP, survived into Rhapsody and is still part of the Finder today. And unlike NeXTSTEP, you won't find the dock here either. That one wouldn't return until the Aqua interface was introduced to the macOS 10 public beta release. One of Rhapsody's key features was the so-called blue box. Later, this evolved into what Mac users knew as the classic environment, a full copy of the classic Mac OS running in a protected paravirtualized session. From a user's perspective, it feels similar to the Macintosh application environment for Unix, booting straight into macOS to run your legacy applications.
So, why not just do it the way AUX did back in the late 80s?
That's a good question. In AUX, Unix System 5 provided the base system and the multi-finder ran directly on top, so Mac applications blended seamlessly with the Unix applications on the same desktop. Rhapsody didn't take that route. Instead, Apple chose to isolate the blue box as a Mac inside a Mac OS, almost like a safety net, while encouraging developers to adopt the Yellowbox APIs. And that decision shaped how the transition would play out. Old apps stayed corralled inside the blue box, while the rest of the system pushed forward with the NeXT frameworks. This strict separation of the environment also made sense in respect of the graphics system. NeXTSTEP was built around Display PostScript, later replaced in OS X by Quartz with its PDF-based imaging model. Trying to merge that with the classic macOS QuickDraw system would probably have meant endless compatibility workarounds and performance issues, so Apple kept Blue Box isolated instead. Poking around on Rhapsody, it offers of course a shell. And whereas later incarnations of OS X report themselves as Darwin, this one still reports as Rhapsody with kernel release 5.3. Rhapsody itself went through several iterations. Developer release 1 in 1997, still supporting both PowerPC and Intel hardware, followed by DR2 in 1998. But by the time Apple shipped macOS X Server 1.0 in 1999, the Intel port had been abandoned. It was clear the future would be PowerPC only, at least for the time being. At WWDC 2005, Steve Jobs revealed that Apple had secretly been maintaining Intel builds of macOS X behind the scenes all along.
Now, I have something to tell you today. macOS X has been leading a secret double life for the past 5 years.
So when the PowerPC hit its limits, Apple was ready. That's when the shift to Intel processors began, marking Apple's second big architectural leap. And with that, Intel support officially returned with OS X 10.4 Tiger in January 2006, the same day Apple shipped its first Intel Macs. From the many architectural changes Rhapsody introduced, one of the boldest ideas was the Yellowbox API, the direct descendant of NeXTSTEP's object-oriented frameworks. Apple even released a version for Windows NT, promising that developers could write their applications once and run them on both Mac and Windows. But the plan was quietly abandoned. At this stage, Rhapsody relied on just two worlds, Yellowbox for new applications and Bluebox to keep classic Mac applications alive. But this approach met resistance from developers who didn't want to rewrite everything from scratch. So Apple introduced Carbon, a streamlined, modernized version of the old macOS APIs, making it easier to bring existing applications forward. Meanwhile, Yellowbox was rebranded as Cocoa, laying the foundation for Apple's future. Together, Carbon and Cocoa set the stage for the upcoming OS X developer releases and the next big transition. Meanwhile, we're still running on Rhapsody and there are still some interesting quirks ahead, such as why can't macOS in Bluebox format an extra virtual hard drive? Is it worthwhile exploring the later Rhapsody-based releases like macOS X Server 1.2 and 1.2 version 3? And what about the SIP drive I've added to the G3? Will it actually work here? In the next part, we'll put these questions to the test. Installing applications inside Rhapsody, experimenting with SIP drive support and diving into open firmware to see how far we can push this system as a true multi-boot machine. What do you think about Rhapsody so far? Share your thoughts in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was part 1 of my Rhapsody exploration story. Thanks for watching and see you again for part 2 next Sunday.